So in physics, there are some quantities, physical quantities, that we need some extra information. Okay? For example, when I'm talking to you that I'm going with a 10 meter per second velocity, the next question you will ask, okay, in which direction are you going? Right? I can give you the magnitude of my velocity, but the direction also is important in physics. Or you can say somebody is pulling you with a force of 10 newtons. So the next question is, in which direction? In physics, if you have a physical quantity where some directional information also is needed, then we call these kind of physical quantities as vectors, okay? But there are always other physical quantities where there is no need for direction. For example, temperature. Today, the weather is 25 degrees Celsius. So there is no need for any direction or nothing. It's just a scalar. Or the mass of an object. It's a scalar, okay? The mass is the number of atoms or whatever quantities in an object. So it does not have any directional information. So there are always some physical quantities. Only a number is enough. Or there are some physical quantities. A number together with some directional information is also important. Okay? So there are scalar quantities and there are vectorial quantities. Vectorial quantities are position, velocity, acceleration, force, okay, momentum, you will see, angular momentum, torque. These are vectorial quantities. But scalar quantities like temperature, mass, speed is a scalar quantity, okay, because I said speed is always a positive quantity, and it may be zero, but it can never be negative. And in your car, the speedometer always show the speed, not the direction of your speed, right? You can go in any direction, the speedometer will always give you some number, that's it. Alright, so I think you can appreciate that why do we need vectors in physics is important. So, before we analyze vectors, first I have to introduce a coordinate system in physics, okay? Without using a coordinate system, talking about vectors doesn't make any sense, okay? A vector in physics or in math, we denote an arrow, straight arrow, with some length and some direction. That's it. This blue line represents a vector. And this vector, as you see, has a direction, right? Its direction is already there. If you put your coordinate system, y and x, like this, it has a direction, and this direction makes an angle 25 degrees with the x-axis, okay? And also, the length of this vector is given. This is a position vector, and it is given by 1.5 meters. So, as you see, there are two numbers in here. One is the magnitude of the vector. This time, our vector is a position vector, and its magnitude is distance, and it is 1.5. And its direction. Direction means this angle. If you know this angle, you certainly know the direction, okay? You certainly know the direction of the vector. So as you see, it is always enough to give only two numbers to characterize or to uniquely set up a vector. Well, the vectors may be represented in two different ways, okay? What I was talking about is the polar representation of a vector. because I have given you the magnitude of the vector and its angle, but I may well express the same vector with its components, okay? The y component I may have given and the x component. These two components also are enough to characterize or to uniquely determine a vector. And this is the Cartesian representation of a vector. This is the polar representation of the vector, and this is the Cartesian. Okay? In Cartesian representation, we are dealing with the components of the vector in x and in y directions. Of course, if you are describing a vector in three dimensions, also there is an extra dimension, z. There is z direction, y, and x direction. But for the simplicity, we will only deal with two dimensions in this chapter. Three dimension is just a generalization. Okay. In Cartesian coordinate system, the components of a vector may be a negative quantity. Okay. These quantities may be negative. Okay. If, for example, I have drawn you a vector in this direction, okay, it's another vector, and this vector with this choice of coordinate system, origin is here, certainly has a negative x component, right? Because when you project this onto x-axis, this is on the negative x-axis, right? So it has a negative rx, but while its coordinate in the y direction or y component is positive still. So in Cartesian coordinate system, the components may be both negative or positive, but the same is not true for polar coordinate system. For polar coordinate system, the magnitude is always a positive quantity. You may not have a negative quantity in polar representation. Okay? And the angle, theta, cannot be infinitely large. Okay? Although the magnitude can be infinitely large, the angle is bounded, right? The angle may be a number between 0 or 360 degrees. If you give an angle which is larger than 360, you end up with the same position. Okay? This is 25 degrees, this angle. Well, you may well say that this angle is not 25, but 360 plus 25. That means 385 degrees. But this time, you see, there are two different numbers showing the same direction. Okay? So, to avoid this, we only limit the angle between 0 and 360. And this is in terms of degrees. Also, we use a different unit system for angles. It's the radian. The angle also can be a number between 0 and 2 pi. Okay? If you are talking about the angles in terms of radians, then you can use this. And pi is a number 3.14, right? Okay, that's enough for representing vectors in a coordinate system. Should I give a break or continue? Okay, let's give a break 10 minutes and then we will continue. Ödevleri arkadaşlar, ödevleri getirebilirsiniz.
Fatih Furkan Erol, benim de o hocam. Şeyi falan hocam, hani ben şey yapamadım, silemedim. Sadece Fatih Furkan, Altıra Erol, Etutmay o kalacak. Hani diğerlerini silemem.
Tamam o zaman.
Benim de iki tane var orada sanırım. Bir tanesini kaydoldum.
So as I said, there are two ways to represent a vector. One is to specify its components. The other one is to give its magnitude or length and the angle of the vector with the x-axis. Suppose you are given the components of the vector. How can you find its length or the magnitude? So if you are given the components, to find the length of the vector is easy. Just take the square of each component, add them, and take the square. This is the magnitude or the length of your vector. And as I said, it is always a positive quantity. It cannot be a negative quantity, okay? In terms of the length or the magnitude, here, this is the length of the vector or magnitude. If you know the magnitude and the angle, you can do the reverse. You can calculate its components. If you know the components, you can calculate the magnitude and the angle, okay? So if you know the components, how can you find the angle? Just divide the y component to x component and take the inverse tangent. When you do this in your calculator, you will find the angle in terms of degrees or radian. It depends on your calculator, okay? By the way, learn how to use the calculator to calculate the angles, okay? If you are working with degrees, then you will end up with a degree value, but you have to set this up beforehand. So, but this is easy to understand. Okay, how can you relate the length or the magnitude of a vector to its components? If you know the trigonometry, if you know the right triangle, then it's very easy. The length here is just square of these vertical and horizontal side of the right triangle. And you know from the Pythagorean theorem, right? And also, if you know the hypotenuse, AY is nothing but A times sine of theta, and AX is nothing but this length times cosine of angle theta. Bunları biliyorsunuz değil mi? Trigonometri. It's inverse. This is arctangent. Okay. There are two ways to write it down. So, an immediate application of these transformations, so to speak, if you know the side of the triangle, you can get the angle and the length or reverse. For example, you are on a beach and there is this cliff and you want to calculate the height of this cliff. Just from the knowledge of this distance, you can always measure by your steps. And this angle. By measuring the distance and the angle, you can find the height of the cliff, right? By using the trigonometry. And you can always measure the angle just by using your arm and just aim to the peak of the cliff, and you can measure the angle and step up the distance. The tangent of this angle will be this height divided by this horizontal distance, h divided by b. Okay, so it's a nice example, nice application of this knowledge. All right, so you can always check this at home. There is a special example to find the angle of a vector angle of the vector with the x-axis. If the components of the vector are given to you and both components are negative, then what you should do, this is important. Just calculate the angle by using the formula. Since by and bx are both negative quantities, negative and negative will make it positive, you will end up with this angle if you are given that bx is minus 2.1 and by is minus 1.7. You will end up in your calculator that this angle is plus 39 degrees. But plus 39 degrees is in the first quadrant. What I mean here is, if you draw the coordinate system, okay, this is the first quadrant, this is the second quadrant, third and fourth. In the first quadrant, the angle is always between 0 and 90 degrees, right? But your vector has negative components. It is definitely true that your vector is somewhere here, because both components are negative. But the result give you that the vector is this. Okay? Then what you should do is, if and only if the components, both components are negative, what you do is you add what you find in here, 180 degrees, okay, to correct this. So this is only true if you have both components are negative. All right, so suppose you have more than one vectors, and you will often face this kind of situation in physics. We have to add or subtract or do some operations with vectors. Let's start with addition first, addition and subtraction. In here, you have three vectors in the coordinate system. You see vector A, B, and C. They have some lengths and, of course, some directions. By the way, you can always carry a vector parallelly to anywhere on the coordinate system. What I mean here is, for example, look at B vector in here. This B vector is exactly the same vector with this one. If I draw a equal length and the direction is the same, horizontal, this vector, B, and this one are exactly the same thing. That means you can always translate a vector from one point, from one region to another region, without changing its direction and its length. This is always allowed. Okay? So suppose you have these three vectors. What I mean is, you don't have to start all vectors from the origin. Okay? Vectors can be anywhere in the coordinate system. It doesn't need to be started at the origin. So your vector A is starting from the origin, vector B is here, and vector C is here. Suppose you want to add them. You want to add them. These may be position vectors. So to find your final position, what you do, you have to add these vectors. Just start with the first vector, and the second vector goes with the tip of the first vector. The tip of the first vector is the starting position of your second vector, and the starting position of your third vector is the tip of the second vector. So do this all for all vectors, and then just connect the starting position of the first vector and the ending position of the third vector. Connect these two points. This vector will be the addition of all these three vectors. This is called head to tail method of adding vectors. In Turkish, ucucu ekleme. This is one way to add vectors geometrically, okay? Head to tail method. So it's very easy. There is nothing special. And of course, this will be your final displacement or position. If you first go with this and this and this, this will be the final net position vector. Well, if you are given the vectors, their components, okay, mathematically, you may have given the components of two vectors. For example, in here, A and B, components AX, AY, and BX, BY. If you want to find the addition of these two vectors, let's call this C, A plus B, you may easily find CX by adding AX and BX. You may easily find CY by adding AY and BY. You never add AX to BY. Okay? So it's nonsense. AX, BY, well, they are different things. One is X component, the other is Y component. To find the components of the resulting vector, just add the components in the same axis. You may have been given vectors, not their components, but their magnitude and their angle. And you may are asked to find the resultant vector. In that case, what you do, first you calculate the components by using the information of magnitude and direction. For example, A is given as 5 meters and the angle is 60 degrees, and B is given as 4 meters and the angle is 20 degrees. First, you calculate AX and BX. AX is just 5 times cosine 60, and BX is 4 times cosine 20. So if you add these, you will find CX, and do the same for AY and BY. Calculate AY, 5 times sine 60, 4 times sine 20. This is CY. And what you do at the end, just to find the magnitude of C, take the square of CX and CY, add them and take the square. To find the angle of C, in this case, what you find, what you do is just divide CY by CX and take the arctangent. And it will be the direction of C. Okay? So everything is straightforward. I think it's very clear. So, what to do for subtracting a vector from another vector? You have B, and you want to subtract B from A. You see in the picture, this is A and this is B. For subtracting vectors, what you do is just take the inverse of the second vector. You have B, and minus B is the same vector, which has the same magnitude, but the direction is opposite, reverse. And take the direction reverse and add to A, that's it. A plus minus B is the resultant vector, A minus B. Okay? So this is, again, head-to-tail method. But finding the resultant vector in component-wise is even more easy, all right? Easier. Just reverse BX and BY, minus BX and minus BY. AX minus BX and AY minus BY is the resultant components of the subtraction. And we have this concept of unit vectors. Unit vectors are special vectors, and they are unique to coordinate system. If you are working with a Cartesian coordinate system, then the unit vector in the y-axis is just a vector along the y-axis which has unit length. Okay, it has no unit, physical unit. It is neither meter nor newtons, nor meter per second. It has just a unit of 1. And it is usually shown with hat, y hat, or j hat, okay? If you see j hat, it's nothing but the unit vector in the y direction. And the unit vector in the x direction is the same. Again, you have a vector which is on the x-axis, and it shows the positive x-axis direction, and it has length of unit 1. It is usually shown as x hat or I hat, okay? It's the same. These are vectors, okay? And any vector in this coordinate system may be written as the sum of two vectors. One is, the first one is, in this sum, the component of A in the x direction times the unit vector in the x direction. Okay? And the second one, the second vector is, the component of the A vector in the y direction times the unit vector in the y direction. So you can always represent any vector in the Cartesian coordinate system as the sum of two different vectors, and these vectors are just multiples of unit vectors in x and y directions. Okay. So an immediate consequence of this is that if you have a vector, if you multiply a vector by a scalar, let's say you have a vector A, you multiply this by 3. The resultant vector is a vector which has 3 times the length of your original vector, and it shows the same direction as the original vector. You see, this is A, and this is 3A. It shows the same direction, but the length is just 3 times. But if you multiply this vector by minus 3, then again, the length will be 3 times, but the direction is reverse. So multiplying a vector by a scalar is straightforward. You either prolong your vector or shrink your vector. If you multiply A by 1/2, then the resultant vector will be a smaller vector, okay? Half of the original vector. So in an example of vectors A, B, and C, they're all given in terms of unit vectors. AX unit vector in X, AY in unit vector Y. And if you want to find A plus B minus C, what you do is, in terms of unit vectors, AX plus BX and subtract CX, and for Y, AY plus BY, and you will subtract CY. That's very easy. But again, the resulting vector is again the sum of two vectors, okay, in X and in Y. So let's come to the kinematics vectors in physics. So having defined the vectors in most general form, in physics we are going to deal with first the position vector. And remember, we also defined the displacement vector on previous lectures. Especially this displacement vector is very important to find the average velocity between two points. Suppose you have two different positions in space, in the coordinate space. The initial position is this one, and the final position is this one. And for every point in coordinate system, there is always an associated position vector. For example, for this point, let's call this PI, the associated position vector is this RI, okay? Just originating from the origin, ending at this point PI. Similarly, the position vector for the point PF is this one, and it is called RF. And in physics, especially in kinematics, you will always wanted to find the displacement vectors, okay? And displacement vectors are defined between two points. For example, if you want to find the displacement vector from PI to PF, what you do is just connect these two points, okay, by a straight line. Of course, this is not a very straight line, and this one is straight line, and this defines the displacement vector between these two points, and it is always shown as delta r, okay? If we want to express this displacement in terms of the position vectors, it is nothing but this difference, that's it. Subtract the initial position vector from the final position vector. This defines your displacement vector, and the displacement vector is this one, this straight one from these between these two points. This may be very obvious to you, but it is always better to put the definitions. Why I'm telling this? Because I will introduce you how to find the average velocity in two dimensions. So far, you have seen the average velocity in one dimension only, but in here, I will explain or I will define the average velocity in two dimensions. First of all, suppose you have this trajectory of an object traversing this blue line, okay, in coordinate space. This trajectory is the real, actual path of the object in space. I mean, as time is running, the object is going along this trajectory at every point, and it goes in this fashion. But we don't know, of course, its velocity. Suppose the object is at point P1, at T1. At a particular time. And at a later time, it passes from P2 at T2, and you want to find the average velocity vector between these two points. How to do it? What you do is just connect these two points by a straight line. And as you can see, this line is nothing but the displacement vector between these two points, right? And if you divide this delta r by delta t, delta t is nothing but t2 minus t1, right? The total time it takes for the object from going from point 1 to point 2, then you will find this vector, the green vector. This is the definition of your average velocity in two dimensions, okay? And as you see, defining the average velocity in two dimensions is nothing like defining the average velocity in one dimension. So you have to deal with vectors in here. Okay, this is the definition. And pictorially, this one is how to do it. Alright, these are abstract things, but whenever it comes to problems, it will be more clear for you. Suppose you have an object initially at this position, is given by in terms of the unit vectors, and the initial position vector, ri, is 2 meters in the x direction and 3.5 meters in the y direction. And 3 seconds later, the object is at another position, r final, and it is minus 3 meters in x and 5.5 in the y. The question is, what is the average velocity vector? So what you do is just apply the definition, find the displacement vector. It is nothing but RF minus RI. That means you will subtract from 3, minus 3, 2. So it makes minus 5 meters in x. 5.5 minus 3.5 makes 2 meters in y. And divide this by 3 seconds, you obtain the average velocity vector. Okay, both components. Minus 1.67 meter per second in x, 0.66 meter per second in y. And of course, you may find the speed. To find the speed, what you do is take the square of each component and add them, take the square. This will be 1.8 meter per second. It is the speedometer of the object, okay? What the speedometer reads. If it were a car, the speedometer will read you 1.8 meter. The speedometer will never read you 0.66 meter per second. It will never read you minus 1.67 meter per second, but it will read 1.8 meter per second. And you can always find the direction by taking the inverse tangent or arctangent of the y component divided by the x component. Okay? I don't know why this added 180 degrees in here. Okay? The result must be a negative quantity in here. So this is not true. Okay, you do this at home. This is not true. So there is one thing that once we have defined the average velocity, if you have this trajectory in the coordinate space, you may ask about the instantaneous velocity vector. Okay? And like in previous lectures in motion in one dimension, the instantaneous velocity vector at any point is always tangent to the trajectory. For example, the instantaneous velocity vector at this point for the object is this tangent line. But of course, the length of this line is can be changed, can be different. It depends on the how fast the object is going, but the direction. Direction is always tangent, okay? For example, you may ask the instantaneous velocity at this point, and this is just the tangent line here. We don't know the length, but the direction definitely will be in this direction, okay? And in here, the instantaneous velocity vector will be in this direction because it is tangent to the trajectory. And next, we also have this average acceleration. I know these topics are boring for you, but I have to do it once and for all. To define the average acceleration, this time we need a change in the velocity, okay? The change in the velocity, not the change in the position. The change in the position defines you the average velocity, but the change in the velocity vector here defines you the average acceleration. And again, for average acceleration, you need 2 points, okay? Suppose these 2 points are this initial point here, and the final point is this one, let's say. First, what you do is draw the instantaneous velocity vectors or find the instantaneous velocity vectors at these 2 points, in initial point and the final point. And next, just translate the final velocity vector to the initial velocity vector position. Okay, here. You can always remember carry these vectors parallelly anywhere. So if you bring the final to the starting point of the initial velocity vector, you form these two vectors. They are starting from the same point, and your average acceleration vector will be on the line connecting the heads of these two velocity vectors, and it will be in the direction towards the v final, the final velocity vector. Okay, this is your average velocity acceleration, and of course the length of the average acceleration is determined by this duration time. This also is must be calculated, and if you divide delta v by delta t, you will find the average acceleration vector. This is how to do, how to calculate the average acceleration in two dimensions. So in this picture again, you see a particular trajectory of an object. The blue line is going like this, and at every point, at point 1, 2, 3, 4, the velocity, instantaneous velocity and the instantaneous acceleration vectors are drawn. And tell me, at first point, point 1, is the object increasing its speed or decreasing? You are given the vectors, acceleration vectors, and the velocity vectors. What happens at point 1? Instantly. Is it increasing its speed or decreasing its speed? Decrease? It is decreasing its speed because the acceleration vector and the velocity vector are in the opposite directions. Okay. What happens in 2? And suppose this time A and V are perpendicular to each other. Is the object increasing its speed or decreasing? But instantly, instantaneous, okay? Don't think the points just before this or after this, just at this point. Instantly, is it increasing its speed or decreasing? Decreasing. Why? Is acceleration vector in an opposite direction to the velocity vector at this point?
Not opposite, in a different direction.
If, but there is a special angle between them. If the acceleration vector and the velocity vector are perpendicular to each other, the object neither increases its speed nor decreases its speed. Its speed stays constant instantly. Okay? The speed does not change, but the direction of its velocity is changing. And it is very obvious from the path, right? From the trajectory. But the trajectory curves after this point, curves like this. It curves. It obviously changes the direction, right? If there were no acceleration vector in this direction in here, then the object would continue its motion in this fashion, straight. Okay? So again, at point 3, the velocity and the acceleration vectors are perpendicular to each other. The speed is not increasing or decreasing, but the direction is changing. And as you can easily guess, at point 4, the speed of the object is increasing because the acceleration and the velocity vectors are in the same direction. Okay, so this completes the chapter 3 vectors in two dimension, and you have now every information to analyze the kinematics of motion in two dimensions. Okay, so we will continue on Thursday, and remember, on Thursday you have your first lab. Be prepared for the lab. You have the lab videos, okay? You know what to do, and you know You have your lab manual, right? Your lab report. Okay. That's it.